When you support your local PBS station, you help make programs like this one possible.
Hi, I'm Kevin Contreras. Get ready for Building Green, the show about creating gorgeous homes that are healthier, more energy efficient, and better for the environment. Today, we're talking about wood. It seems simple, right? Cut down a bunch of trees and make them useful. But there's more to it than that. We have to make sure that that wood is grown and harvested properly, that it's safe for us, and that we only use as much as we need to. On our straw bale house, we will use less wood than is thrown away on most jobs. So let's get to it today on Building Green.
Last week on Building Green, we stacked the straw bales like bricks inside our steel post and beam frame to create the walls of our home. The straw bales will eventually be plastered to become structure and insulation in one. Where bales are not appropriate for insulation, we used an insulation made from recycled blue jeans and baby blankets. In a process where these post-industrial wastes are shredded and made into bats for insulation instead of going into our landfills. Today's challenge is to use wood responsibly. For our house, we want to use good quality wood doors and windows that come from managed forests or recycled sources without breaking the bank. We have to make sure that all of our wood is obtained properly and doesn't have added chemicals that can outgas and harm us. The most responsible way we can use wood is by not using much of it. Since we're building our walls with straw bales and our second floor joists and roof structure out of steel, we won't use much of this precious dwindling resource. The wood we'll need to complete my family's green dream home will be used for windows and doors, roof decking, garage walls since they aren't made of straw bales, eaves, second floor, subfloor, and finished floor.
All of the following items came from a huge remodel in our area. The owner had been told these things were going into the dumpster, so we removed the windows, doors, cabinets, and placed them in several remodels of our own. We saved tens of thousands of dollars. The biggest challenge is removing the items without destroying them in the process, and then finding the right places for them to be repurposed. Ah, nice little lazy Susan. An important thing about salvaging cabinets is that they can either be built as boxes brought here and screwed into the wall, or they are often custom built in place. When that happens, the amount of energy taken to take them out without destroying them is just not worth it. These happen to have been built as boxes. It'll be easy to unscrew them, take them off of the wall, and take them right out of here. Here's a great example of something to salvage and reuse. This perfectly good jacuzzi bathtub. The owners have decided that they just don't want it anymore and they want something else because they don't use it. We've been able to purchase it for pennies on the dollar because they were just going to throw it away otherwise. We're going to take it out of here and reuse it somewhere else.
I had some specific ideas for custom designing our home's windows and doors from repurposed wood and found a company called Eco Timber that sells sustainably harvested and reclaimed wood products. I spoke with Daniel Harrington, EcoTimber's Director of Architectural Sales and Marketing, at the Green Materials Showcase.
Other things, like something I've been particularly interested in is this Jara, correct? And is it coming out of buildings, actual buildings that were existing?
Yeah, it comes out of buildings in Australia. Mm-hmm. I think this particular batch came out of wool barns.
Wool barns.
It's recycled, it's a beautiful hardwood. In Australia, they used to use Jara for framing and beams. Mm-hmm. Typically, you wouldn't use hardwood for that, but there was so much of it around the turn of the century that there's a lot of old buildings that you can get it out of.
And it's actually a form of eucalyptus, right?
It is.
That's great. And any other woods that you're getting out of the old existing structures?
This is what we call our tobacco barn oak. It comes out of Kentucky tobacco barns.
Right.
It's actually just the barn siding. This is old growth white oak that comes from Chicago meat packing plants. So A lot of different sources out there.
Amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
All the different places. And how do all of these compare in prices, like the Jara to the bamboo?
The palm. The bamboo is really affordable. It's very competitive with sort of low-grade wood flooring products. And it's actually more durable than those. The Jara in woods like this, old growth white oak, they're a little more expensive because of the labor involved in deconstructing buildings and pulling the nails, and everything has to go through a metal detector, and so that does cost a little bit more. And the Forest Stewardship Council certified woods generally nowadays are cost neutral. On the tropicals, there's a little bit of a premium just because that type of forestry is a little more expensive in the short term. But the prices have come down a lot because there's a lot more certified forest now than there used to be. So.
That's great. Well, it's great to see you guys and hear that you're doing so well.
All right.
And look forward to making a purchase from you guys.
Thank you very much.
I really wanted to use the reclaimed jar hardwood for simple windows and doors. So I met with Ron Dorian, my favorite window maker.
Hi, Ron.
Hi, Kevin. How are you doing?
Very well.
Yeah,
nice
good to see you.
So you're getting this all worked out with the sills and everything?
Yeah, we are.
He showed me how they can make the reclaimed jar of wood go even farther in the process.
What I'm most interested in talking about is what you've come up with here.
All right, this is an engineered wood, and it is it's a fir filler, or a reclaimed wood. It can be even used as wood that's been reclaimed.
And it doesn't look like solid pieces. It's sort of an oriented strand board, isn't it?
Itself has been laminated together. There's many pieces here that have been stacked up and laminated. Right. 70% of the wood is saved by using a filler such as this.
Right. The point being that we can use this recycled wood to create long straight planks that use 70% less of the good wood. And then Ron is adding dual pane glass to keep sound out and simple hardware to result in beautiful inward opening French casement windows.
I purchased the entire lot of Jara that EcoTimber had and placed an order with Ron for the engineered wood to make our windows and doors. Ron took part of the Jara for that and got started. We still needed 2x4 and 4x6 lumber for our eaves, beams, and decking. When building green, we want to get wood that is sustainably harvested and certified by the Forest Stewardship Council. FSC is a nonprofit organization devoted to encouraging the responsible management of the world's forests. FSC sets high standards that ensure forestry is practiced in an environmentally responsible, socially beneficial, and economically viable way. Companies that sell timber and forest products seek certification as a way to verify to consumers that they have practiced forestry consistent with FSC standards. To get the FSC stamp of approval, forest operations must meet 57 criteria, including protection of local wildlife, minimal use of chemical pesticides, even the guarantee that loggers can unionize. If a forest makes the grade, its wood products get branded with the FSC logo and a chain of custody number, which allows them to be traced back to their source. Michael Washburn is Vice President of Brand Management for the Forest Stewardship Council of the United States.
The Forest Stewardship Council is a global organization. We have members in 65 countries. And we set standards for environmental and social performance as it relates to logging, where it happens on the ground. A lot of people don't realize that the forest industry is a global marketplace. So when you go to your local lumber yard, you may buy solid wood flooring or 2x4s or plywood that could have come from almost anywhere on the planet. There's really no correlation between where you live and where your wood comes from. So our system has to be global to deal with the full suite of issues around how to protect, conserve, and manage forests responsibly. That includes dealing with issues like illegal logging, which still happens in many parts of the world. It even happens in North America. It includes dealing with the protection of biological diversity and making sure that people are treated fairly in the process when logs are harvested and taken to a manufacturing facility to be turned into products. The Forest Stewardship Council has as a cornerstone of its integrity what we call the Chain of Custody Certification Program. It's our view that if you're going to present a product in the marketplace as being an environmentally and socially responsible product, you have to be able to defend that claim. And the way you do that is by ensuring that the product that is provided to the customer is truly connected to the forest somewhere in the world that has met our certification standards. So the system requires that once a log is harvested in a certified forest, it's followed all the way through the process, from the logging site to the mill where it's turned into lumber, for example, from that mill to a flooring manufacturer, and then from the flooring manufacturer to the distributor and to perhaps the retail shop where you purchase the product. Every step of the way, our accredited certifiers have gone in and inspected the process to make sure that the inventory has been managed to keep the certified products separate from non-certified products. That way, when you see the FSC logo on a product, you're assured that your transaction has connected to responsible forestry somewhere in the world.
Today, FSC certified woodlands now blanket 15.5 million acres in the U.S., up from a mere 1.4 million in 1995. Internationally, the numbers are even more compelling, with 135 million acres of FSC-approved forests covering the globe. We've got to remember to save the forest for the trees.
Most of us have plywood, particle board, and OSB in our homes. It's a very commonly used building material. The problem with these products is usually a high level of formaldehyde. The formaldehyde is used in the adhesives that glue the pieces of wood together to create the sheet that then can be used for cabinetry, furniture, roof decking, subfloors. It's widely used in construction in the U.S. So now we have some alternatives to that toxic outgassing of formaldehyde that we know causes migraines, sinus trouble, depression, anxiety. The list goes on, the health problems that are caused by formaldehyde in the indoor air. So we can now purchase formaldehyde-free plywood, OSB, and other substitutes for these products. If you don't have those yet in your area, sealers are available that seal in the outgassing, specifically the formaldehyde outgassing from particle board, plywood, and OSB. They're gaining in popularity and becoming more available all over the country.
Let's talk to one of our favorite green builders, Dennis Allen, about engineered wood panels, specifically OSB, since that's what we're using.
The oriented strand board is a product that's made from little pieces of wood. I mean, each one of these little things is a bit of wood. It's made from very small, fast-growing trees, usually on tree farms. And so you're not cutting down big trees. You're not cutting down any virgin forests. You're now starting to be able to get these panels where the wood even comes from a Forestry Stewardship Council certified wood.
What about the glues in oriented strand board?
Urea formaldehyde is the one that continues to outgas and is not good for health.
Right.
Many people react to it and find that they're congested all the time, or they're sneezing, or they have itchy eyes, or they have respiratory problems. Mm-hmm. All this can be attributed to that kind of formaldehyde.
Right.
The phenyl formaldehyde are a much more stable, inert kind of formaldehyde, and it's a very effective glue.
To find out more about non-toxic OSB, you can visit our website at buildinggreentv.com.
We're using repurposed wood for our doors, windows, and floors, FSC wood for our eaves, and non-toxic plywood for our roof decking, second floor, and garage walls. You're probably wondering if this is all going to cost us more. It's actually going to cost us less than if we'd bought modern windows with all the gadgets and hardware. As for the FSC wood, it's going to cost us more, but we're not going to use very much of it, and the reduced environmental impact is going to be well worth it. As for the healthy plywood, if it saves at least one doctor's visit.
There are lots of ways to conserve wood when building green. Here's an idea for you.
So today's easy step involves the fine art of dumpster diving. We need a couple of 2x8s on our job, and as I drove by our neighbors, I noticed they've got this dumpster full of old 2x8s that they've pulled out. It's always easier for a contractor to throw away lumber and buy a new one than to pull nails out and redo it. But for me, when I'm doing my own project, I would much rather than spend an hour going to the store and buying the wood, I'd much rather pull something out of a dumpster and use it right away. You always have to be careful not to injure yourself, of course. And I always ask the people who own the dumpster or are renting the dumpster, if I can do this, make sure that they're okay with it. And sometimes they don't let me because they don't want to take the liability risk. But for the most part, they're very willing and always happy to see somebody else use it. So we'll see what we can find here. Oh, this one right on top is beautiful. Almost no nails in it. Straight. Probably been in this house for
20 years or something. Cut off the top of this, I can use it right away. And another one. I don't need another one too long. Oh, this one will work. You got a few nails in one side of it. It'll take me about 5 minutes to take them out. Cut that off, and I've got another beautiful piece of wood. So, instead of taking all that time to go buy wood, I have it, and I'll be back on the job in 2 minutes.
Now, let's see how Ron's team is progressing with the windows and doors made of engineered wood. They're using the laminated inner core pieces for our large doors, and laminated pieces of solid wood for our windows and sills. It's great to see craftsmen working with all the best tools. Ron explained how they edge glued two pieces of the laminated stock to create the bottom rail of the door. As he says, that's a big hunk of wood. If it wasn't engineered, it would be a major piece of tree. He also showed me the windows. They turned out great. Simple French casement inward opening windows. After Ron has inserted dual pane glass for better insulation and sound abatement, we take the finished doors and windows back to the house and start installing them. When we were putting in the straw bales, we connected 6-inch wide light gauge steel studs from the floor to the beam above for each opening. This gives us a solid place within the bale walls to insert the windows and doors.
Without this, installing windows in floating wooden bucks in straw bale walls can be challenging. The steel vertical studs give us the ability to add horizontal 2x4s to support the windows and define our bale placement. We sand each window before installation. After the steel studs have been lined with wood and waterproofing material, and a plywood shelf has been installed to support the bales above the windows, we wrestle each window into place. The large ones take several guys, but we lift them in, get them plumb, connect them to the wood,
and then we spray the windows with orange oil, a non-toxic, easy on the senses way to bring out the beautiful natural color of the wood. Although this is something that we'll have to reapply about every 6 months in our mild climate, it's better than having toxic chemicals outgassing in the house from other wood finishing products. As each window or door is installed, I go around to inspect and wipe them down. They're going to be stunning when the house is finished, and energy efficient as well. Dual pane windows are manufactured with two sheets of glass separated by a layer of inert gas. This design reduces energy costs, condensation, and color fading due to sunlight, and increases the overall comfort in a home. Our Forest Stewardship Council certified wood for our eaves has arrived, and the first job is to cut 4x6s for rafter ends. Since the roof structure is made of steel, only the last few feet exposed will be wood, which was an aesthetic choice. Each 4x6 is cut, sanded, and stacked for staining. Because we're attaching our wood to a steel frame, we install 2x6s on the underside of the steel and then 4x6 rafter tails under them. Next, we install the non-toxic oriented strand board for the roof decking. We use the same OSB to construct our exterior garage walls as well, since the garage is not made with straw bales. Michael Gordon, our foreman, has been working on this for most of the day. On our second floor, we are laying down 3/4-inch plywood. This healthy OSB contains a non-toxic bonding agent. First, we glue it to the steel floor joists.
So in laying down the plywood for our second floor here over these metal joists, we were looking for a glue that had a low VOC content. Most of the glues out there have a high VOC or volatile organic compound content, and those accumulated over time can actually make you sick. So we found this glue that is solvent free. Initially, the carpenters were not crazy about it because it didn't stick as readily as they're used to, but they found that once they put the plywood down and connected it with the screws, that it had quite a good strong bond.
It took several days to lay all of our healthy plywood down for the second floor. We also constructed our garage walls with the non-toxic OSB and installed our custom windows and doors made from repurposed wood on the first floor.
As I watched our dream house go up, I realized that Building Green is all about having the right information, materials, and professionals. Well, who would have imagined that so much of the wood for our doors and windows would have come from an old wool barn? It's a great repurposed material that is going to look fantastic when the house is finished. We did our part for the forest by getting FSC certified woods and kept harmful chemicals out of the house by finding good glues and plywoods. Next time on Building Green, we're going to be plastering the exterior of the house and pouring limestone windowsills. I'm Kevin Contreras. Join us next time on Building Green. For in-depth information on today's show and to learn more about all aspects of green building, join us on our website at buildinggreentv.com. That's buildinggreentv, as in television, .com. See you next time on Building Green.